Thought of discussing some recent developments that have happened in the last couple of years in terms of intensive care. We used to have ICUs and we used to have CCUs earlier. And we believe that the ICU will look after people who are sick because of liver disorders, because of renal disorders, maybe because of respiratory problems. And the CCUs should be quiet, no activity, no noise. And that is a place where people with acute coronary syndromes would be admitted. But there is a sea change that has happened in the last couple of years, I would say in the last decade, because we realized that the impact that we had after the CCUs came in 1960s, we could reduce the mortality of acute myocardial infarction, which at that time stood at something like 20%, to 10%, 9%. But further reduction of mortality did not happen in the 80s, 90s. And we realized we need to do something else rather than being segmentalized in terms of how we manage our patients, because patients have to be managed in totality. And a lot of these people have comorbid states. And so we realized that some of these cardiac emergencies need to be dealt with a team approach by a cardiologist, by an intensivist, by a respiratory physician, by a person who has interest in dealing with renal disorders. And that is what has made impact in the last 8-10 years. What I'll be sharing with you in the next 20-25 minutes as to how, where are we placed in terms of our intensive care thoughts. This is what shows how our approach has changed in terms of, see, we may not be managing that many STEMI patients as we were earlier. We have to deal with infections, liver disorders. We perform some of these procedures like bronchoscopy, mechanical ventilation, more. So we are dealing with a subset of patients in a cardiac care unit, which has many other comorbidities. And also these cardiac disorders are subsequently resulting in disorders of the other organs because of impaired perfusion that happens when a patient gets admitted with acute myocardial infarction or acute decompensated heart failure. The renal system gets involved, the respiratory system and other organs, you very well know, get involved. So what we need to look at is not just the cardiocentric management. Of course, we need to look at the hemodynamic parameters. We also need to look at that our patients do not develop what is called as MODS, the multi-organ disorder syndrome, or the SIRS, the systemic inflammatory response syndrome that occurs in these acutely sick patients. So we develop a multi-organ kind of an approach when we are dealing with, and of course the underlying cause will have to be treated, because what you are doing with hemodynamic monitoring, with some of these inotropes or mechanical support systems, is only trying to buy some time. And unless you manage the acute, the condition which has pushed your patient into this situation, you will not be able to manage these people. I am aware a lot of you today have developed your own intensive care units. You are managing many more sick patients than were being managed. And of course, these patients will need to be effectively. So you need to develop a clinical approach in terms of not just the blood pressure, but you need to look at their preload status, their fluid responsiveness. Because when a patient comes with, invariably by the time a patient comes to you in an acutely sick condition, patient is hypotensive, a lot of them, and the best thing that you can do to these people is to provide them with adequate preload, to give them fluids. And the guidelines also show us that if you have a septic patient, a patient with septic shock should be given at least 2 liters of fluid before you dwell upon starting inotropes. And very often what happens is low blood pressure, reflex thought comes to our mind, we start multiple inotropes on these patients. But what will impact mortality in these people is giving fluid to invariably even cardiac patients who are hypotensive, who are having cold extremities. You give them fluids and you will be rewarded. Their kidneys will be saved, they'll start bringing out urine. So fluid response, preload status is something that should be in the back of your mind when you are managing these patients. Invariably, these patients have been sweating, they have been administered diuretics by somebody outside and they have not even eaten anything. They have had vomitings, which are consequences of acute pain. So they have more than one reasons to be hypovolemic, which has pushed them into hypotension. We need to monitor these people, of course, and bedside echocardiography in the intensive care unit is something which is there in all hospitals and which should be there with most of the physicians, I would say. Be conversant, because an echocardiogram is not to be done to look for the ejection fraction contractility. In fact, in the emergency room, an echocardiogram is done more often to see the fluid status of your patient. How is the IVC? Is it collapsing? Is the IVC distended? And if your what is the RA size? What is the RV size? And it doesn't need much of expertise. It will tell you the fluid status of your patient. It will tell you how much fluid you can. If the IVC is collapsed, it's collapsing on inspiration, you know your patient is fluid depleted. And invariably, these patients with acute myocardial infarction, you give them fluid, especially those with inferior wall infarcts, a lot of them with RV infarcts. Just the administration of fluid is going to make a big difference. The other thing I would like to emphasize on you is have some idea about tissue perfusion. Why do we want patients' blood pressure to be up? To look at on a monitor, a good blood pressure might sound very nice to you, but actually what you're looking at, what you're wanting is a tissue perfusion. Is the cerebral perfusion, is the splanchnic perfusion, is the renal perfusion adequate, is the patient? Because ultimate aim of any cardiac contraction is to maintain organ perfusion. It may not happen that you are administering high doses of inotropes, which is compromising on the perfusion pressure and organ perfusion. So keep a concept of preload, keep a concept of tissue perfusion in your mind, because that is essentially what is going to make a difference in terms of outcomes in your patients. So from an era when we used to monitor the CVP of our patients, we started putting CVPs, and then we were putting many Swan-Ganz catheters to measure the pulmonary artery occlusion pressure, which reflects the LA pressure. But subsequently, it was realized that a lot of these people developed infections, and our respect for the Swan-Ganz catheters, I would say by the time we realized and we learned something about the hemodynamics also, and for that reason, we started putting less and less Swan-Ganz. Most cardiac patients today do not get monitored with Swan-Ganz, although surgeons, I would say, still like to put Swans on their patients because they want to monitor the pressures. Their patients are hemodynamically more unstable. From a pressure-centric approach, we came down to a volume-centric approach, and that is what I would say all of us, you and I, need to develop. What is the volume status? What is the left ventricular end diastolic volume? What is the global end diastolic volume of our patient? And if our patient's end diastolic volumes are all right, then we need to use inotropes, mechanical supports, if that is not so. And now we are monitoring dynamic pressures. What is the pulse pressure variation? Many times you must have seen, you put an arterial line in a patient with respiration, you can visibly see that there is an inspiratory fall in pressure and expiratory rise. So there is a respiratory, whenever there is an excessive respiratory variation in pressure, your patient is volume depleted. So you can look at the pulse pressure variation, you can look at the systolic pressure variation, and even the stroke volume. So from a pressure centric to a volume status of your patient, and now we look at these dynamic parameters as to how your patient is, so as to know the volume status in our patients. And this is something which has come to intrude into most CCUs and ICUs, what is called as the pulse index continuous cardiac output. So what you do is just put an arterial line, and instead of putting the Swan-Ganz catheter, which will measure the left ventricular end diastolic, you just have the CVP. And these PICO catheters, these pulse index continuous cardiac output that you get will be dynamic, will be over a period of time. You will be monitoring it, and you will know with the measures that you are applying in your patient whether it is giving a positive response in terms of cardiac output, what is happening to the systemic vascular resistance. Of course, these are derived parameters. These are not actual parameters. So their correlation needs to be taken with a pinch of salt. you should not solely depend upon these, but these are supplementary monitoring methods with which you can monitor your patient's hemodynamics and also, of course, use your clinical judgment. We have various types of these, and they essentially look at the systolic phase of the arterial curve. So this could be done by the area under the curve, what is called as the PICO. It could be done by the LIDCO, when the pulse pressure analysis, and on the spot what we use in our hospital is the FlowTrack, which measures dynamic tone at the various points. So you can measure patient's cardiac output. It will give you, all of them give you interpretation in terms of what your patient's cardiac index is, what the stroke volume index is. So without using a Swan-Ganz, you will be able to measure the systemic vascular. And it is said that if you will maintain a SVR between 800 to 1000, because you are using some of a combination of these inotropes, and unless you use them pertinently, the tissue, you might get a good pressure wave. You might get a good adequate pressure, but what is happening is compromised tissue perfusion in your patient. Of course, an echocardiogram can tell you what your patient's hemodynamic status is. So clinical judgment is of paramount importance. Just touch your patient, feel your patient. Is the patient having cold, clammy extremities? Is the patient sweating? Even in septic shock, you have two kinds of patients. One is a warm shock, one is a cold shock. And the management will be different in a patient who has a warm shock as against a cold. So similarly, in a cardiac patient also, the arterial blood pressure you look at, urine output, whether what is the hourly urine output, serum lactate levels if they are more than 2, base deficit measurements, when the base deficit is more than -8, your tissue perfusion is being compromised. What is the central, rather than the arterial blood gases, the mixed venous blood gases. And the venous saturation, when it is less than 65, it tells you excessive oxygen extraction is happening and your patient's tissue perfusion. So develop this thought process of what the tissue perfusion, what the organ perfusion is, because essentially that is what is going to take your patient away in any cardiac shock. This is a scoring system which is being used most commonly, the APACE 2 scoring, which looks at the acute physiology, AP, and the chronic health score of the individual. And if it can beautifully tell you, if the score is more than 35 or 25, there's a 50% mortality, and if the score is more than, so it can, there, these are all clinical parameters which will tell you what your patient's chances of survival are. Now, what can we do to these patients who are admitted to our intensive cares with acutely decompensated cardiac status? These are some of the things which I'll just touch upon in the next 10-15 minutes. First of all, of course, pharmacological inotropes, vasopressors and inodilators. Which ones to use in what status? The inotropes that we primarily have are epinephrine and dopamine. The vasopressors that we primarily have is norepinephrine and vasopressin. And the inodilators that we have is dobutamine and milrinone. So essentially it is a play of these six pharmacological agents which you will be using, and if you use them pertinently in your intensive care, I know, I'm aware most nursing homes today have these infusion pumps, so we are using these, but which ones to use at what stage, I'll just spend 1 or 2 minutes on this. Now the therapy with this, as I have already overemphasized at the cost of repetition, the volume status of your patient should be adequate. Do not start inotropic agents unless your patient's preload, patient's volume status is adequate. Because we know these inotropic agents can only buy time for us. They do not impact mortality unless we do something to the underlying cause. And this is a very beautiful study, the SOAP 2 study, which came in 2010. Most of us used to believe that in septic shock, the treatment, the inotropic agent or the vasopressor of choice is dopamine, is norepinephrine, and in cardiac patients, the choice agent is dopamine. And you and I as physicians are all very fond of dopamine, and we use it as the first choice. But in the last couple of years, this particular trial has changed guidelines. Now we know even in cardiac patients, the norepinephrine is the vasopressor agent of choice before dopamine, because dopamine is arrhythmogenic, it is emetic also, it generates vomiting, and invariably there is vasodilatation at initial load, and whereas beyond 10 microgram per kg there will be vasoconstriction. So the initial agent, this particular trial showed that not only in patients of septic shock, but even in patients with cardiogenic, you see in patients with cardiogenic shock, there was even greater benefit that we found than in patients with septic shock. So the initial vasopressor of choice that you use in patients with even cardiogenic shock, with acutely decompensated cardiac patients who have a now a mean pressure of between 65 to 70 or a 30 millimeter decrease in pressure is something that will warrant that you institute these vasopressors to buy time so that tissue perfusion does not get affected. So this has changed. We know norepinephrine has alpha effects and beta effects. Alpha receptors are in the blood vessels and it causes vasoconstriction. We have two types of beta receptors. Beta 1 receptors which are in the heart and it causes increased contractility and increased chronotropic effect, and beta 2 receptors are in the peripheral blood vessels and they cause vasodilatation. So norepinephrine primarily acts on the alpha receptors to increase the blood pressure. In fact, there will be some reflex decrease in heart rate when you are using norepinephrine. So your patients, but I would like to caution, use should be restricted to the shortest time. Invariably, you go to the emergency, you go to the ICUs, you find your residents are using, they are very happy with a pressure of 130-80 and norepi is going at something like 15 microgram per kg. Invariably, the patient's tissue perfusion is being compromised. Use these agents in the least possible dose to maintain an adequate tissue perfusion, which is a mean arterial pressure of 65 to 70 millimeters of mercury. We are not aiming at very high pressures so this needs to be assessed on an hourly basis so that you reduce. Now, if you have started norepi on a patient and you find your patient is kind of cold, patient is sweating, you realize that tissue perfusion is not adequate in your patient. The pressure has come up, but such is a patient where you should add dobutamine to norepinephrine. We know dobutamine acts primarily on beta 1 receptors. It acts also on the beta 2 receptors, but the blood pressure does not fall significantly because of increased cardiac output that happens. Dobutamine is an agent which should be used when there is impaired tissue perfusion, but blood pressure is maintained. You cannot use it as a first choice when the patient's blood pressure is less than 90. So in such a patient, you will first use norepi and then you will add dobutamine to increase their tissue perfusion. We have these other agents like milrinone, levosimendan, which is a calcium sensitizing agent, which can be used subsequently in some of these patients. So the guidelines today say that in cardiac patients, the inotropic agent or vasopressor of choice is norepinephrine. If you are able to increase their blood pressures to a level, then to improve tissue perfusion, the second agent of choice will be dobutamine. And invariably, one sees patients in the intensive care have 5 or 6 infusion pumps running because the resident feels that I have to use all these agents. The person puts them on epinephrine. No data to show that more than 2 inotropic agents impart any benefit. So be very restrictive, very hesitant to add a third inotropic agent amongst these on a patient, unless your patient's blood pressure is not coming up with norepinephrine. In a rare situation, you might use vasopressin in such a patient. So have some respect for these agents, but use them in the minimal possible dose. This is another development which has happened, which is available to most of the centers, the non-invasive ventilation, which has made a big difference in terms of respiratory support that we provide to our patients in intensive cares. And this, the cardiogenic pulmonary edema trialist study, this particular study showed that a lot of us use the bi-level non-invasive ventilation to our patients. But the evidence based is for the continuous We all, a lot of us feel that CPAP is for obstructive sleep apnea and BiPAP is for patients who have acute BiPAP is for patients with hypercapnic respiratory disorders. For patients of cardiogenic pulmonary edema are not hypercapnic, and there is evidence, there is in fact a beautiful editorial from PGI by Dr. Jindal in the postgraduate medicine, which is a very prestigious, in which they have shown that trials have shown that CPAP makes one out of seven patients that you will be treating with CPAP support in acute pulmonary edema, besides giving furosemide, morphine, whatever you are doing, propped up position, it will aid and support your patient. And one out of seven intubations can be prevented by pertinent use of non-invasive ventilation, that is a CPAP mode. Now, this can be done either with small machines, which a lot of you must be owning and which are available in all hospitals, but it can also be done with the invasive ventilators that we have. The advantage with that is it has an inflow and an outflow circuit which is separate. So if your patient is acutely sick, you can even use one of your ventilators for providing non-invasive support to your patient. But initially, when you put a patient on a non-invasive ventilation, do not strap, because patient, unless you put it on yourself, you will realize it's so claustrophobic. And a patient who is acutely sick, you push them into, from a high flow oxygen, you want to push them, they will react. So support them, initially just hold it with your hand and then put the straps after a period of time. Never use non-invasive ventilators in patients who are drowsy, who are sick, and who are not responding for 4 to 6 hours, because these are time buying modalities. Of course, every intensive care unit should have a non-invasive ventilator because it's pretty cheap. It only costs 2 lakhs or so. You can even use your routine ventilators, and a lot of intubations can be prevented, not only in patients of COPD, where it has been shown to be of benefit beyond doubt. It has also been shown in many meta-analyses, in this Cochrane meta-analysis, you can see that CPAP provides. Multiple studies have shown today that you can avoid intubations in these people. So this is the second modality that you will be using in your patients. And these are some of the newer modifications that are coming. There are masks coming and there are bags coming which will be used rather than just the small screens. And some of these things are available now in our country. The third thing that you do that bothers you in your patients who are acutely sick and who come to your CCUs is fluid overload state. Patient who comes to you in pulmonary edema, patient is grossly bloated, patients, and we all who manage patients in intensive care, we all realize as long as your patient is producing urine, you know there is adequate organ perfusion, because it's besides mentation, that's the only thing which tells us how the perfusion is. And once your patient starts producing less urine, the whole gamut of metabolic acidosis complications starts. So how do we support these people? There is a thought process that high dose diuretic therapy is better than low dose diuretic. So invariably you will put these people on high dose diuretics. We also, a lot of us have realized that infusion of furosemide produces better diuretic responses than diuretics used in bolus form that we all use in our ICUs. We also realize that a combination of a thiazide diuretic metolazone with a loop diuretic furosemide is better than a single, because it acts at different levels. So some of these things you can use as combination therapy, furosemide in an infusion form to have your patients responsive. But if still there is no response and your patients are on a ventilator, your patients are acutely sick, you will have to use a continuous renal replacement therapy. Now, a hemodialysis dialyzes your patients over a period of 4 hours, so it has to remove those toxins. So the hemodynamic load that happens to your patient is much more, because it has to do that job over 4 hours. A slow hemodialysis does it over a period of 8 hours. Because it takes a longer time, your patient's hemodynamics are disturbed to a lesser extent. But a CRRT, the continuous renal replacement therapy, puts it over 24 to 48. In fact, not many times we use it for 72 hours. So you can extend it so it is more soft on the hemodynamics of your patients. And you can use a ultrafiltration if the patient is just fluid overloaded, not urine output is not adequate, the renal functions are not too bad, you can just use ultrafiltration. You can use convection or veno-venous filtration if you're not adding any fluid. You can use the diffusion like a hemodialysis if your patient is also having renal failure. So this CRRT provides hemodynamic stability. If your patient has raised ICT, then certainly this is the modality of choice for renal replacement therapy. So if a patient has hemodynamic instability, patient has raised ICT, the modality of choice is this. Of course, it has disadvantages that an anticoagulant has to be used, these patients cannot be mobilized, and it is certainly more expensive than a hemodialysis or a SLED. But this is one thing which saves a lot of lives in patients who are sick. This is an important trial which a couple of years back we had much more faith in CRRT, and a lot many times the high dose infusion diuretic therapy was being used less often and people used to be put on CRRTs. But this, the CARES-HF study which came 4 or 5 years back showed us that this form of therapy was not superior to the stepped approach of diuretics. So give a fair bit of trial with us with an increasing infusion of furosemide, add on metolazone, and if you find that there is no response, probably that is the time when ultrafiltration or this continuous renal replacement therapy. This is some our work that we presented in the last API. Older age, the level of azotemia, severity of acidosis, these are all predictors of bad outcome. But when used pertinently at the right time, it can be fairly useful. So in fact, the thing about most of these forms of therapy is these should not be used too early when they can be avoided, but they should not be used too late by the time that the whole battle is already lost and your patient is in an irresponsive state. Now some of these mechanical circulatory assist devices are there, which I just want you to be conversant with, which are available in the armamentarium of any cardiac care unit. Before that, I would say defibrillation is something that made the biggest difference, and this is how you place the pedals. And today I see lot many more patients coming from nursing homes who are defibrillated. Patients go there with ventricular fibrillation, with ventricular tachycardias. So many lives are being saved today because of the availability and usage of defibrillators in our state, and that's pretty heartening. Earlier, we used to have the monophasic defibrillators in which a higher energy level of up to 350 joules used to be required. Today, we have the biphasic defibrillators in which you use much lower energies. Like if you are cardioverting a ventricular tachycardia, you can use 50 to 75 joules. For atrial fibrillation, you can use 100 joules. And for ventricular fibrillation, of course, you will need 200 joules. So the methods of using a defibrillation are very well known to you. You cardiovert patients who are in ventricular tachycardia, a patient of ventricular fibrillation has to be defibrillated, whereas some rhythm, if it is there, you will cardiovert and you will synchronize it and then use it. This is a modality of therapy with now acute pulmonary thromboembolism is being diagnosed much more frequently with the availability of D-dimer test, with the availability of vascular Doppler of the legs, and also with the availability of CT, I would say. A CT angiogram can diagnose a pulmonary thromboembolism very easily. So lot many more pulmonary thromboembolisms, even in mobile people, we find so many times a pulmonary thromboembolism is diagnosed. And one modality which we have found, patients who come with acute shock, we published this work in the World Journal of Cardiology a couple of years back. These people, a mechanical fragmentation with a pigtail catheter and then local instillation of a thrombolytic agent can help. It has been used for acute pulmonary embolism as well as in subacute pulmonary embolism. In both these, and subacute pulmonary thromboembolism is a condition, a lot many more of these people will go to chronic thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension, and we know that's a very frustrating disease to treat. A few words about mechanical support system. I would start by saying that data from randomized trials on effectiveness and safety is limited. Some of the support measures that you can use is, of course, the intra-aortic balloon pump, in which a balloon is placed over the descending aorta and it inflates during diastole and deflates during systole to let the heart pump out. An impeller device is something which picks up blood from the left ventricle and pushes it into the aorta. I have no personal experience of using impeller, but I know impeller device has been used in our country. ECMO is when you are supporting the heart and lungs both. I'll just talk for 5 minutes on ECMO also. And a tandem heart is being used now in our country for chronic heart failure, dilated cardiomyopathy, shock patients, which I also, again, have no personal experience, but I am aware that about 100 odd of these have been implanted. It's very expensive, costs about 60 to 70 lakhs. So it has to be used per day. But these are some of the things. The one that we have is an intra-aortic balloon pump. And before 2012, we used to feel that an intra-aortic balloon pump is very useful. In fact, there was a trial which came, the Shock 2 trial, which shocked most of us, because we used to have a very sacrosanct belief in this. And today, the guidelines have pushed an intra-aortic balloon pump. But any interventionist who has used this and saved lives would have much more. There are areas in medicine where evidence base cannot be collected, but you have experience and you see these devices saving patients day in and day out. And for this reason, intra-aortic balloon pumps, you will find patients who come acutely unstable with unstable angina, acute myocardial infarction, to buy time before a definitive form of therapy is used. These are very useful. They are especially useful in mechanical complications of acute MI, like VST, mitral regurgitation. They are even more beneficial. But do realize that don't use them very early, because we do not have evidence base for their significant benefit that they impart. And that's the reason the 2013 ACC and also the ESC guidelines have pushed them as class 2B guidelines. Most of us may not like it, but this is the status of the evidence base. I'll just spend 5 minutes on ECMO. ECMO was talked of when Jayalalitha had the cardiac arrest, and it was in the news that a patient has been put on ECMO. Now, ECMO is nothing but extracorporeal membrane oxygenation. So if your patient has a cardiac arrest, you want to buy time, just as the surgeons do in an OT. They do cardiac arrest and they used to do an open heart surgery today, or earlier even coronary bypass. Today coronary bypass is done as a beating heart surgery, but earlier it used to be done, the patient used to be put on a heart-lung machine, the heart would be standstill, and the oxygenation and the propulsion effect was done by the heart-lung machine. Similarly, just to imagine that the same job is done for a period of days, even up to 3 weeks, if you are supporting the respiration and you are supporting the pump function of the heart. And virtually, it's so fascinating to see, there is a straight line, you do the ECG of the patient, but the patient is living, because you are maintaining organ perfusion and you are also maintaining cerebral perfusion. The problem with the ECMO is that most arterial cannulas, you have to put if you are doing an arteriovenous ECMO, you have to take blood from the artery, the femoral artery, and push it into the femoral vein. And very large size, because the whole cardiac output has to go outside. Now you imagine a coronary angiogram is done with a 6 French, 5 French, at the most 7 French if you are doing complex interventions. These are 15 to 19 French arterial and 20 to 25 French venous cannulas. So these are very thick cannulas, and a lot of these people are already on vasoconstrictors, so their vessels are vasoconstricted. So I'm just trying to make you aware, the ECMO system has its own issues, but what it does have is a centrifugal pump, it has an oxygenator and a temperature maintenance. So what you are doing in this is, now there have been these are some of the advancements. I don't think I'll bother you with this. But what has happened is people are now transporting patients on ECMO. We are not using the surgeons. We are putting these cannulas percutaneously also for starting an ECMO. And that makes our job faster, because when the patient is acutely sick, you can put these people on an ECMO very fast. And this is essentially how an arteriovenous ECMO works. You take out the blood from the femoral artery, it goes through the centrifugal pump, it goes through the oxygenator, and then you push it into the vein, and so the job of the heart and the vein is done. We in our institution there are about 8 or 10 centers in the country which do it. We have one of the largest experience in the country. We've done about 100 odd ECMOs in our patients, and two very specific indications. We've done in a couple of patients with cardiac arrest, with almost one-third patients surviving, and this is a big study which has been done. It's a pooled data which shows that 29% of these patients, almost one-third of these patients, could be discharged with favorable neurological. Mind you, these are patients who had a cardiac arrest, in whom a CPR is done, and CPR patient is not responding to CPR. So they are virtually going, all of them, and still if you can save one out of three of these, but ECMO is expensive. ECMO cannot be used in all people. So there is a lot of data and a lot of centers. This is the work that we published in the Journal of Emergency Medicine. In fact, it's for the first time in the world that aluminium phosphide poisoning, the cell phosphoring, ECMO has been used in our state for the first time. And now ECMO is being used in other parts of the world also, which use wheat preservation, because it is peculiar to our part of the country. And you all know aluminium phosphide poisoning, initially we used to give a lot of fluid. Dr. Bali is here. When we were doing DM, we used to push a lot of fluids to these patients. Some people started giving magnesium sulfate, and these were the only modalities. And those patients who develop a cardiac toxicity due to the phosphine gas, which gets liberated very early when there is a contact of this tablet with fluid, it evaporates. And 70 to 80% of these patients used to die. We published this work and we could save some of these people with aluminium phosphide poisoning. Almost 70% of these patients who were very high risk. Then a larger series we published last year in the Indian Heart Journal. You use the veno-arterial ECMO because you are supporting the heart as well as the lungs in these people. They have a very toxic chemical type of myocarditis and a peripheral circulatory failure. So it's a dual type of a shock that these patients with cell-phos, aluminium phosphide poisoning have. And almost 50 of these patients we have managed with ECMO. This is the other last 2-3 months we had a lot of swine flu. And in here, all that you need to do is you need to support their lungs. And if a patient is not maintaining saturation on a ventilator, then you will have to put them on a support system. This is a venous ECMO. Here the heart is fine, but you are supporting the lungs. So this is less complicated. You take the blood from the veins and push it, because the heart is not. So in swine flu patients, you will be using the venous ECMO. And of course, how best, where to, it is said that only if there is a more than 50% mortality of a given condition, should you put a patient on ECMO. If the survival chances are more than 50%, do not put a patient, because we know ECMO has a huge cost involved and ECMO has a lot of complications. So I would end here in the next 6-7 slides. I won't bother you too much by saying that this is a beautiful paper which came last year. I think it was from Korea. And they showed that whenever in a CCU, with you and me as physicians, as cardiologists, whenever we involved an intensivist, their mortality significantly reduced. So an intensive care is not to be limited to intensive ICUs that manage liver failure or cerebral patients. A coronary intensive care unit concept has to be there, because a lot of these issues can only be managed by an intensivist. So the take-home messages would be, as I said and I started, basic treatment strategy includes the normalization of hemodynamic parameters. Of course, we have to prevent other organ damage, because heart pushes blood to other organs. And if we are not treating them early, these patients will develop renal failure, respiratory ARDS. And stabilization initially will have to begin with fluids and then use inotropic agents as a second choice. Non-invasive hemodynamic monitoring is a modality which has come, which is widely available and being used in our country, and it just needs an arterial line. It is safe and fairly correlates with the hemodynamic parameters that you get with more complex devices. The non-invasive positive pressure ventilation, the CPAP, BiPAP, can save intubations. And so you can, many of these patients you can manage with acute pulmonary edema and also with acute respiratory distress. Ultrafiltration or the CRRT is a modality which should be used after you have exhausted your options with diuretics in a fluid overloaded state, because it does not impart significant mortality benefits to you. Intra-aortic balloon pumps I have already shared. The ECMO I have shared. Just a couple of my own thoughts as to how we should manage our patients with who are sick, who are acutely decompensated. First and foremost, friends, is a team approach. A physician or a cardiologist needs a nephrologist, needs an intensivist for managing these patients, because arterial blood gas analysis, other issues, the renal parameters issues are there. Any intensive care that you develop should have a nocturnal management plan which is as good as a daytime plan, because most mortalities occur at night time when you are not there. So your methods should be designed so that your patients are as well managed at night as they are during daytime. Arterial blood gases, of course, are available and should be used in these people. This I have already shared with you. Inotropes, do not overuse them. Develop your own protocol. The treatment principles should be protocol based. Your junior staff should know. It's not that there are 5 consultants in a unit. Every consultant has his own protocol. The poor nurses, the junior resident is going to be totally confused. So have a protocol which is used for all patients, which is similar. And invariably, these patients do not need a day bide twice a day or a once a day round. They need an hourly basis monitoring, because you will need to change your treatment plans significantly. Management of arrhythmias, of course, makes a huge difference. And I quote an important thought: more complicated devices do not necessarily mean better outcomes. They are to be used only when they are absolutely indicated. And today we live in an era, as Dr. Sekhom was also sharing and Dr. Pritam Gupta also shared with all of you, that we live in an era when we are under scrutiny. We are being evaluated by our patients. And costs of medical treatment are very enormous. The service that, or the number of patients that we can save is certainly larger than what we could do earlier. But there is a huge cost involved. So cost is a very, and withdrawal of these support systems, it's a very critical issue. You should have a protocol, because invariably people start feeling that their patient is irretrievable, although you might still feel, and when their money is being exhausted, you need to develop your own protocol. And this is one of the, mind you, the most difficult part of an intensive cardiac or an intensive care: how to manage, how to handle patients. Because you tell them for 20 minutes that patient is sick, this, that, ye, wo. In the end they will say, "Doctor sir, theek ta ho jayega na ji." And you feel that all the 20 minutes that you spend with them have gone wasted, because they don't want to listen to a negative outcome, especially when they have spent so much. So your support withdrawal protocols should be in place, and you should be versed as to when you are going to tell your patients. Invariably, this can solve or prevent a lot of problems that happen in the intensive care units. And of course, your own hospital data. There might be something else given in the literature, but what is your outcome of a given condition? Have an analysis 6 monthly. Which are the patients which are likely to respond in my scenario, my circumstances, and then use those methods. So intensive care is a serious business. It can land you into problems, but it is also very satisfying. So we need to develop our protocols and then follow them in our institution. I would end here, invite you for this cardiology meet that we are hosting in Amritsar on 30th of September. And I'm thankful to Dr. Sekhom for awarding 8 credit hours to this meet. It's a 2-day meet which will discuss some of the current issues on cardiology. Thank you very much for your patient hearing.